Hello everyone, I'm Rashmi Mangla. I'm working as an assistant professor for the BBA department of St. Andrews Institute of Technology and Management. The subject that I'll be teaching today is Human Rights and Values. This is our third lecture for Unit 1. Now the topic that will be covered today are, we'll be covering all the article from 15 to 13 under UDHR. We had already covered articles 1 to 14 in our previous class. Now today we'll be covering 15 to 30. All right, let's begin. Article 15. Article 15 deals with right to a nationality. Now everyone has the right to a nationality. No one shall be arbitrarily deprived of his nationality, nor denied the right to change his nationality. That means everybody has got a right to nationality, all right, and nobody can be deprived from it. Hum kisi ko mana nahi kar sakte uski nationality follow karne se. And if anybody wants to change their nationality, then also we cannot deny them. We cannot. There are certain rules and regulations that have to be followed, but right to nationality cannot be denied if anyone wants to change their nationality also. Then Article 16, right to marriage and family. Men and women of full age without any limitation due to race, nationality or religion have the right to marry and to found a family. See, all the men and women who are of full age. Now full age means the right, you know, the correct marriage age. For example, India, we talk about the perfect marriage age. For girls it is 18 years and for boys it is 21, right? So until and unless they are of this much age, they cannot get married. But once they attain this age, they have a right to get married and to form a family without any limitation due to any race, due to any nationality or due to any religion. They are entitled to equal rights as to marriage, during marriage and at its dissolution. And both men and women will have equal rights at the time of marriage, while marriage, like when they are already married, and even if, when they are dissoluting their marriage, when marriage comes to an end, that time also they are entitled to equal rights. Marriage shall be entered into only with the free and full consent of the intending spouses. Only when both girl and boy are ready, then only they can enter into a marriage contract. Then only they can get married. The family is the natural and fundamental group unit of society and is entitled to protection by society and the state. Obviously, the family is a natural and fundamental group, all right? Because it's natural. As in, when we are born, we have a family. So it is a group unit of society and we are entitled to protection by society. This is a society, our family is the one who protects us. And we are entitled to this protection of society and state. Then Article 17. Article 17 deals with right to own property. Now everybody has got the right to purchase their own property. Har koi apni khud ki property khareed sakta hai, and this is a right. Nobody can deny you from it. So everyone has the right to own property alone as well as in association with others. That means you can individually buy a property or you can buy it in association. Maybe you and your friend, you both want to buy a piece of land or maybe a flat together, all right, in partnership. That 50% you are giving, 50% he is giving. So that way also it can be done. You can buy in association or individually alone. And no one shall be arbitrarily deprived of his right, property. And nobody can deprive you of your property. Koi aapki property aapse alag nahi kar sakta if you have purchased it. Then Article 18, right to freedom of thought and religion. Everyone has the right to freedom of thought, conscience and religion. This right includes freedom to change his religion or belief and freedom either alone or in community with others and in public or private to manifest his religion or belief in teaching, practice, worship and observance. So basically what we talk about here is that everybody has got the freedom of thought and religion, that anyone can follow any religion. and they are free to you know, just follow any thought. That every religion have their own sayings, although the, all the religions, you know, whatever things are said in their books or in their, you know, like for example, we talk about Quran, we talk about Gita, we talk about Guru Granth Sahib. Ultimately, you know, the major concept is the same, but and everybody is free to follow any of the thoughts of any religion and free to teach, practice or worship any religion. Nobody can stop you from that, because that is the right that you have attained under this article. That even if you belong to a certain religion and you wish to change to another one, you can do that. You have the right to do that. You can preach any religion, you can follow any religion. Then, right to freedom of opinion and expression. Now, we have the right to, you know, we can express our thoughts in front of others. We have that right. We can keep our opinion. We can express ourselves. So we have the right to do that. Nobody can stop you from expressing yourself or from giving your opinion. So everybody has the right to freedom of opinion and expression. This right includes freedom to hold opinions. That, as I told you, freedom to hold opinions without interference. That nobody can interfere. Koi aapko mana nahi kar sakta apna opinion rakhne se. And to seek, receive and impart information and ideas through any media and regardless of frontiers. That means you can seek or you can receive. You can receive information from any of the media, from any medium you can receive. And nobody can just stop you from that. So you have the right to express opinion and even to get the ideas from others. Then, Article 20, right to freedom of assembly and association. Everyone has the right to freedom of peaceful assembly and association. No one may be compelled to belong to an association. Now, everybody has the right to form a peaceful assembly. We can form an association, we can form an assembly, but it should be peaceful, and no one may be compelled. Nobody can be compelled to belong. If you want to form an association, if you want to be in part of an association, you can do, for sure. But nobody can be compelled. If somebody doesn't want to be a part of any association of person or any group, then he or she cannot be compelled. We can't force him to do that. So it is as per the choice of one individual. Then next one, Article 21, right to take part in government. Now when we talk about this, everyone has the right to take part in the government of his country. How can we take part? Can we choose the representative of a country? Are we in India? Can we choose our representative? Yes, we choose our representative. How do we do that? By voting. We have the voting rights given and we choose our own representative on the basis of our own preferences. So everybody has that right. So everyone has the right to take part in the government of his country directly or through freely chosen representative. Everyone has the right to equal access to public service in his country. So we have the access to public service in our country also. Now, the will of the people shall be the basis of the authority of our government. Now, you know, which government will come into existence? On whose basis we judge that? On the will of the people. The more number of votes a party gets, that is a party who wins. And how do they win? On the basis of will of the people. Jis party ko log zyada vote karte hain, that one wins. So everything is dependent on the will of the people. And this will shall be expressed in periodic and genuine elections. Where do we express our will? In the elections, which shall be by universal and equal suffrage and shall be held by secret vote or by equivalent free voting procedures. So voting can be done in any of the ways, but government is chosen by the people and we have a right to take part in the government because we choose our own government. Then Article 22, right to social security. Everyone as a member of society has the right to social security and is entitled to realization through national effort and international cooperation and in accordance with the organization and resources of each state of the economic, social and cultural rights indispensable for his dignity and free development of his personality. That means everyone, whosoever is a member of any society, he or she has the right to that social security, and they are also entitled to realize what their national effort and international cooperation also. Then Article 23 says right to work. Everyone has the right to work, to free choice of employment, to just and favorable conditions of work, and to protection against unemployment. That means hum sabke paas right hai that we can work anywhere, and we also have the right to choice of employment. The kind of area where we want to work, we can choose on our basis. Nobody can force us to work in a particular sector. For example, I'm working in a teaching sector. Even if I want to go and join the corporate sector, nobody can stop me from that, because I have the right to work and I have the right to choose the kind of work which I want to do. And not only that, we have the right to just and favorable conditions of work. That means the place where we are working, we need to have favorable conditions there, and protection against unemployment. We can also be protected against unemployment. Apart from that, everyone without any discrimination has the right to equal pay for equal work. Everybody has got the right that they should be equally paid if they are doing equal work. For example, in an organization, a man is also an assistant manager and a woman is also working as an assistant manager for another team. Although they are working for different teams, but their work is exactly the same, and they both are working on the same, they both are working as an assistant manager. So they are entitled to get equal pay because they are working equally. So irrespective of, irrespective whether he's a man and she's a woman, they are entitled to get equal pay. Everyone who works has the right to just and favorable remuneration, ensuring for himself and his family an existence worthy of human dignity and supplemented, if necessary, by other means of social protection. So if we are working, we have a right to just and favorable remuneration. Ki hume jo remuneration mil rahi hai, it should be just. It should not be that we are underpaid. Maybe you are working more and you are getting the amount less. So you should have a just remuneration which is fit enough for you to run your family, which is fit enough for you to live a healthy life with a human dignity in the society. Then not only that, everyone has the right to form and to join trade unions for the protection of his or her interest. If you think you are somewhere or the other being exploited, so you have the right that you can join trade unions, and if needed you can protect your interest. So that's all about right to work. Article 24 tells us right to rest. Everybody has got that right. Nobody can stop us from our own personal space. If we want to rest, if we want some leisure time, we can surely get that. Nobody can stop. But yes, including reasonable limitation of working hours. It doesn't mean that if you are working from 9 to 6 in the office and aap tab apna agar right exercise karna chahoge, I have the right to leisure and mujhe rest karna hai, main 9 se 12 tak rest karunga. So that is not the way. You have right to leisure, but yes, you have certain limitation for working hours also. The time when you are working, you will be working. Now, yes, you have got breaks in between, that is for you obviously, but then this right to leisure applies irrespective of the working hours. When you have your personal time, you have the right to rest. Not only that, we have right to periodic holidays with pay. We can get periodic holidays and they are to be paid. We have a right to that. Then, Article 25, right to an adequate standard of living. Everyone has the right to a standard of living adequate for the health and well-being of himself and of his family, including food, clothing, housing and medical care, and necessary social services, and the right to security in the event of unemployment, sickness, disability, widowhood, old age and other lack of livelihood and circumstances beyond his control. So basically, everybody has a right to have a standard living that is, which is fit enough taki wo ek healthy and good life jee sake. So everybody has a right to that standard living, and which includes all these aspects which I just told you. Which all aspects? For example, food, clothing, housing, all these things are included in their healthy living. in their well-being for oneself and for their family. Not only this, motherhood and childhood are entitled to special care and assistance. In the case of motherhood and childhood, special assistance is required, and all children, whether born in or out of wedlock, shall enjoy the same social protection, whether they are along with their family or they are not, but they require social protection and it has to be given to them. That is a right, because everybody has a adequate standard of living. Then Article 26 gives us right to education. It's one of the important ones. Everyone has the right to education. That means everybody has got the right that they can be educated, they can learn. Education shall be free at least in the elementary and fundamental stages. That is, you know, the basic stages, where basically first to eighth, as we already know that the government is giving free education to children. They even provide midday meals so that children are motivated to come to government schools, isn't it? And nowadays the situation of government schools is quite good. You know, they are just enhancing their working conditions. So education shall be free at least in the elementary and fundamental stages. Elementary education shall be compulsory. It should be compulsory that everybody is entitled to be educated at the elementary level. Technical and professional education shall be made generally available, and higher education shall be equally accessible to all on the basis of merit. Higher education sabke liye accessible honi chahiye, but on the basis of, because there are so many candidates, so a merit has to be set on the basis of which candidates can be selected for higher education in one or the other educational institutions. So a merit list has to be prepared, obviously, but yes, everybody is accessible to it. Then education shall be directed to the full development of the human personality. Education should be such that it develops our overall personality, and not only that, it should strengthen the respect for human rights and fundamental freedoms. We should be enlightened with the thoughts of human rights, and we should strengthen the respect for these rights and for those fundamental freedoms that we have got. It shall promote understanding, tolerance and friendship among all nations, racial or religious groups, and shall further the activities of United Nations for maintenance of peace. So education should promote the understanding, the level of friendship among nations, among social groups or religious groups, and not only that, it should further, you know, it should further activity the United Nations. Why? So that peace can be maintained in the overall world. Then Article 27, right to participate in a cultural life. In cultural life, everyone has the right freely to participate in the cultural life of the community, to enjoy the arts and to share in scientific advancement and its benefit. That means everybody has got the right to participate kisi bhi community ki cultural life mein, koi bhi participate kar sakta hai. You can enjoy the art, you can share the advancement and those benefits. Nobody can stop you from doing that, from following the cultural life of any community. Everyone has the right to the protection of the moral and material interest. We can protect our moral and material interest which resulting from any scientific, literary or artistic production, whether of which he is the author. So you can protect your interest if you are the author of any of such things. Then Article 28, right to a social and international order. Everyone is entitled to a social and international order in which the rights and freedoms set forth in this declaration can be fully realized. So you have a right that you are entitled to an order, be it social or international, but you are entitled where your rights and freedoms can be realized, where you can realize your rights and freedoms, and you can work on it, you can exercise your rights. So we have the right for that. Then Article 29 gives us the duties and limitations. Now apart from all the rights, we have certain duties also. Everyone has duties to the community in which alone the free and full development of his personality is possible. So we all have the duties where our overall development of our personality is possible. In the exercise of his rights and freedoms, Everyone shall be subject only to such limitations as are determined by law solely for the purpose of securing due recognition and respect for the rights and freedoms of others and of meeting the just requirements of morality, public order and general welfare in a democratic society. So we need to exercise our rights and freedoms, and we are subject to such limitations. Only such limitations can be imposed by us which have been imposed actually by the law. Apart from the limitation made by law, no other limitation is imposable on us. We have all our rights and we are free to exercise our rights and freedom. We just have to follow the rules and regulations which have been abided by the law. Those needs to be fulfilled. Last one, Article 30, Salvatory Clause. Now salvatory clause, basically, you know, salvatory, individual meaning of the word salvatory is a repository or a place where we can store things safely. Now, so basically, nothing in this declaration may be interpreted as implying for any state, group or person any right to engage in any activity or to perform any act aimed at the destruction of any of the rights and freedoms set forth herein. All the rights and freedom which we have studied up till now. So no declaration has been made and nothing has been implied and no right has been given to anyone to destruct, you know, ki wo in rights ko destruct kare, in rights ko affect kare, aisi right kisi ke paas bhi nahi hai. And this is the rule which makes the human rights formula functional. Because of this clause only human rights formula is functional. So these were all the rights which we had studied. We had covered all the rights. The rights which we have studied, we'll just quickly recall them. Article 15 gave us right to a nationality. Article 16 gave us right to marriage and family. Article 17 gave us right to own property. Article 18 gave us right to freedom of thought and religion. Article 19 gave us right to freedom of opinion and expression. Article 20 gave us right to freedom of assembly and association. Article 21 gave us right to take part in government. Article 22 tells us right to social security. Under Article 23 we have right to work. Article 24 right to rest. Article 25 right to an adequate standard of living. Article 26 right to education. Article 27 right to participate in cultural life. Article 28 right to a social and international order. Article 29 duties and limitations. Article 30 salvatory clause. So children, revise all the articles which we have studied, because your MCQs and we can have your MCQs made from these. These are the very important parts from where MCQ questions can be made for you people. Or quiz can be conducted from here. Now you have to state the rights enumerated in Article 15 to 30, which we revised just now. Please do this. Stay tuned for the next lecture for the upcoming content of the unit. Thank you.